Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the European and External Relations Committee in session five. I'd like to remind members and the public to turn off mobile phones and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers during the meetings should ensure that they are switched to silent. Apologies have been received today from Tavish Scott, MSP, and some other members will be joining us once they have finished attending another committee meeting, and I believe there's one member in particular who's been held up because of problems on the trains today. Our first item of business today is consideration of the BBC draft charter and draft agreement, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting our first panel of witnesses: David Smith, Managing Director of Matchlight; David Strachan, Managing Director of Tern TV; Rosina Robson, Head of Nations at PACT; Donald Campbell, Chief Executive of MG Alba; and Natalie Usher, Director of Screen at Creative Scotland. Welcome to you all. The background to this is that the charter, the draft charter, has been published by the UK government in the last couple of weeks. We have been told here in Scotland that we must debate it before the October recess, so that we in the Parliament, so that we can feed into the scrutiny that the charter is going to be put under in the UK Parliament, and that means that this committee scrutiny has had to be arranged at rather short notice. We would have, I'm sure many of us would have liked more time, but I'd like to thank you for coming at short notice and just explain that background. Can I perhaps start by moving straight to questions, because we're under quite a lot of time constraints, by asking the panel what they see as the strengths and weaknesses of the Charter in terms of delivering for their sector in Scotland? Who would like to start? Perhaps one of the independent production companies.
I think that the Charter offers a number of checks and balances in the first instance, which there haven't been before, which allow for scrutiny by this place and by other organisations. And also it sets out in stone, in tablets of stone, the ambitions which the BBC has, and an acknowledgement that it needs to redress what has been an imbalance in the way it represents the UK.
Thank you. David Smith?
I think that the Charter is a very welcome step forward. I think that it is not the end of the journey by any stretch, and the service agreement that flows from the Charter is going to be crucial to how the BBC operates across the UK across the next 11 years. I think there's some very useful new wording, public purpose, clause 6, public purpose. In commissioning and delivering output, the BBC should invest in the creative economies of each of the nations and contribute to their development, is a real win, I think. And I've had it echoed to me from people within the BBC that they see that as a win as well. So yeah, I think it's a step forward, but by no means the end of the journey.
Okay. Would anyone else like to contribute?
Yes, certainly. I think from PAC's point of view, and maybe taking a broader sort of UK approach as well as the impact it's going to have in Scotland, I think we're pleased overall with the overall shape of the Charter and the agreement. I think certainly from our point of view, there's going to be more opportunities for both production companies in Scotland and across the UK to pitch for opportunities, because the BBC is going to be that much more open. They'll be opening up to 100% commissioning over the sort of course of the charter period over the next 10-11 years. So there's going to be more opportunity for Scottish companies to pitch, as well as companies across the UK, and certainly that's, you know, positive step from our point of view. We're working through a number of sort of issues at the moment with BBC around BBC Studios, which we can perhaps come on to later on. But overall, you know, I think we're pleased with the overall shape of the direction that the BBC is going to take over the next 10 years.
Donald?
One of the strengths of the Charter is that there's a commitment there to supporting the regional minority languages of the UK. And in particular, we are pleased in that in the draft framework agreement, there's a specific commitment to supporting the partnership with MG Alapa and the Gaelic TV channel BBC Alapa. believe it probably falls short in that it doesn't set out a coherent policy towards the minority languages, and it doesn't set out a consistent way of dealing with the two minority language channels, S4C and BBC Alba. But we welcome the direction of travel and also the commitment to fostering the creative economy in the nations. I think that's a big step forward.
Thank you. Natalie?
I think I'd echo all of those points, and then I suppose just picking up on one additional positive, which is the appointment of Ken Macquarie as the Director of Nations and Regions, which we would hope to be a positive outcome for us here in Scotland.
Thank you very much. I know that the Scottish Government had a number of asks which are in the Charter, such as an enforceable service licence agreement and a commitment to the continuation of support for Gaelic, as Donald Campbell has alluded to. There were some asks that were not delivered, and I just wondered if you would care to reflect on them. One of them was a commitment to a fairer share of the licence money in Scotland to invest in Scottish programme making, and also the creation of a Scottish board, not just a BBC-appointed subcommittee. And the key thing, I think, that has been pushed by stakeholders is where commissioning lies. Is the commissioning capacity, will this charter ensure that commissioning happens in Scotland? And I wondered if you wanted to reflect on that. David Strachan.
Thank you. Yes, we would very much like to have seen those things. This is the first year that the proportion of licence fee raised and spent in the nations has been published by the BBC. And the fact that only 55% of the licence fee that's raised in Scotland is spent in Scotland, I think, is indefensible culturally, economically, and politically. They're 55%. Needs to be said again and again and again in the context of the BBC to remind them that it's a measure of the lack of reflection. You asked about commissioning, and that is the process by which that change in cultural reflection would happen. And yes, we would very much have liked to see a commitment to the licence fee raised in Scotland being managed and spent in Scotland. It makes a world of difference if a Scottish producer has 95% of the cost of a production in his pocket and then goes to London and says, would you like to put in the other five? And then we've got a network programme. That completely changes the balance from what it is at the moment, which is that you go to London where the perception of what the rest of the UK is not necessarily the same as our perception would be, and they tend to think that if you're going to say anything about Scotland at all, you should go back and get a little bit of the Scottish opt-out money added into your budget, which is completely not what the Scottish opt-out money is for. So we do need to change those things. We will continue to be arguing for that within the BBC post the settlement.
Thank you. David Smith?
There is a genuine imbalance in how the licence fee is spent and raised across the UK. It's quite a staggering imbalance, and it's not one that was revealed prior to these accounts. 55% at best of what is raised in Scotland is spent in Scotland. At least 95% of what is spent in Wales is spent in Wales, and actually that excludes some spend on S4C, so it's estimated 105-110% of what is raised in Wales is spent in Wales. England is a net beneficiary in that it draws in funding from across the UK. Northern Ireland is sitting around 75% of money raised spent in Northern Ireland. That means essentially that a licence fee payer in Scotland gets 55p back for every pound they put in, where somebody in Wales gets 110p back. You see the logic. I don't think you can divorce those figures from the lack of audience satisfaction that's been measured across Scotland. And I think that you have to ask why Scotland is seen as this net contributor. It's often been said in rooms like this that we also get the network services, that we benefit from the BBC, Radio 4, everything that are pan-UK. It's absolutely true. So does Wales, and yet they seem not to be contributing towards them. You also have to ask why all of those central services are based in London. There's no longer any reason for that to be the case. You could move any one of the services around the UK. Glasgow is a very fully functioning broadcast community. So does Belfast, so does Cardiff. I think on top of that, you have to really think about the network share of spend. Network is the most important, most valuable part of programme spend on television channels. We're 9% of the UK population, 9% of licence fee payers. So you would think that Wales, which is sitting around 5% of both of those figures, would have less of a network share in terms of spend than Scotland does. In fact, it's got about £3 million more. So they're sitting at around 69 million, and we're sitting at about 66 million. So there's a real imbalance that needs to be addressed. So the charter is very welcome. It shows a direction of travel that I think is really positive, and lots of language coming out from the BBC in the last week that echoes that. But there is a fundamental block there. And I think if you can shift that spend so it's more in balance across the UK, things like quotas, commissioning power, that's just a natural consequence of that shift. If we can get the money right, everything else will flow.
There's nothing in the BBC charter, as I understand it, the draft charter, that would stop BBC management from making those decisions that you've outlined and need to be made.
No, yeah. it's all within their gift to decide.
Yeah. Okay, I think I'll pass over to Lewis MacDonald before.
That's very, very interesting, very helpful. I mean, I suppose looking at it in the context of what, for example, the Economy Committee of this Parliament said in the last session about encouraging and enabling independent production, I guess the question is whether what's before us today and will before Parliament when we debate it next week is going to enable that shift. I think everyone in responding to the convener's first question said this is the right direction of travel. Is it sufficiently clear what that direction of travel is in order for us to be confident that the charter period will see a change in the right direction in terms of the quantity of independent production, for example, in terms of support for Gaelic language and the other things that we've talked about?
Well, there's clearly an economic outflow from Scotland, and I think it would be very welcome if there was a specific strategic commitment over the lifetime of the next charter to addressing that by the BBC. I think Gaelic broadcasting would play a very important role in that and offers an opportunity for the BBC in Scotland. It's already a success, and it offers, I think, the platform for further success and for serving audiences in the way that the BBC want. In relation to the prior question about should there be a board for Scotland, I think if there is a high-level strategic commitment to redressing the economic imbalance, I think a board in Scotland would be very useful. A key mechanism in addressing the imbalance is through the systems of quotas, but actually quotas are an intervention in a sense. Content is king, and there's no lack of creative talent in Scotland whatsoever. What sometimes there is a lack of is, I think, confidence in the sector, the ability to commit to creating a really strong domestic market. And if there's a strong domestic market, which includes BBC Alapa as part of it, an integrated part of it, I think then you can punch into the international market as well.
And any other thoughts on what?
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously the charter is a sort of first stage, and then obviously there's a conversation to be had with Ofcom about the exact shape that the service lines or the operating framework actually takes and how that incorporates what's needed from Scotland's point of view. I mean, certainly in the BBC white paper, there was a very clear commitment to continuing with the out-of-London quotas. Certainly, PACT, as always, will continue to support the out-of-London quotas going forward. And I noticed from some of the background documentation on the charter that Ofcom is considering possibly raising or changing those quotas in some way. So obviously that's a conversation that we would, very pleased to sort of shape Ofcom thinking on that essentially. But I think it comes down to, and I think both the Davids have touched on this, is actually you have the quotas, but it's actually how the money is spent locally and how the money is spent on network programming as well.
Sorry, before David comes in, just because I guess what you're saying, because the quotas don't guarantee, it was maybe Donald Campbell's point about quotas are an intervention, they don't guarantee how
the quota. There's no guarantee in built in as to how that quota is met, and it doesn't necessarily stimulate additional independent production or production here in Scotland. Is that your point, Rosina?
I know, for example, this week the Ofcom out of London register is being published, I think, on Thursday. So obviously that sort of lists all the productions in Scotland and in the other nations that have been sort of produced here. And that always, from our point of view, stimulates a conversation with Ofcom about how those quotas are being met and whether there's real investment coming into Scotland and whether that's sort of short-term or long-term. So it's certainly something we have an eye on and a debate we like to influence.
We don't want to be arguing about numbers and percentages forever and having to drill down into those, but they are the tool by which we measure those things. And at least they ought to be the tool by which we measure those things. But when the rules and regulations are being implemented in the letter, but perhaps not the spirit, then we have to drill further down into the processes and how the numbers are interpreted. So that, for example, if you look at the BBC statistics, they will tell you that a significant amount of investment has been made in the independent sector. That means that investment has been made in a number of independent companies, some of which may spend most of their money by buying the services of BBC Scotland's Pacific Key in order to deliver studio shows. Technically, that's independent spend, but actually most of it is going back into the BBC. Some of it is being spent on companies with very little presence here, most of whose profitability then drifts back to London. It is being represented as having been spent here, but it's not. And as a result, we have a weak independent production sector here compared to what it should be after 10 years of the 9% target. We will persist in using the mechanisms which are set up by the Charter and the support and engagement that we've had from all levels of politics in Scotland to explain, not in, we hope, in any kind of whinging way, but, you know, just to say, look, these are the facts. This is how it is. Ought it to be different?
There's a question came back to me last week from somebody within the BBC asking if my view of what is and is not Scottish and is off Scotland, to use the wording of the white paper, would be reflected back to me by other producers within Scotland. I don't have the answer to that question. I think what you can say about production from Scotland is that there are companies that are inarguably genuinely headquartered here. All of our staff are here. Our profits and IP are reinvested in Scotland. The gross value added of our activities is within Scotland. And there are companies who move to Scotland temporarily, rent a desk or two, put up a brass nameplate, and consume quota, and disappear as soon as their commission has done. Between those two points, there's a continuum. And the quota and the mechanism that decides what is and is not Scottish could pick a point in that continuum and say, that's where the line is drawn. More usefully and more quickly, because this does come down to BBC choice, the BBC could simply choose to commission from those companies who are inarguably Scottish. If it is a Scottish quota, spend it in Scotland on Scottish content. Now, I go back to the previous point, which is that there's a bigger hole here, which is this £100 million plus imbalance of net contribution to the UK, kind of the BBC across the UK. I think if you get both of those, there's a journey we're going to have to go on across the next 11 years where we see this rebalanced. Because if we continue to meet network through what's been called lift and shift, Scotland will end up with very little actual Scottish production. We'll end up with a service economy.
Just for the benefit of people who are watching who might be coming to this new, could you give us an illustration of what lift and shift means?
It's where a project or the business of a company is displaced from where they are normally based to another part of the UK to meet a quota. The early examples were things like The Weakest Link, which came and went quite quickly, Waterloo Road, which came and went quite quickly. I think a current example which we've raised with Ofcom is IMG Sports Media, and it's snooker coverage. There are hundreds of hours of snooker coverage from Sheffield that are badged as Scottish and set against the Scottish quota. When we looked into who constituted the team, what gave them the substantive base within Scotland, there did not seem to be much of a substantive base. There were desks rented within PQ, Pacific Key in Glasgow. There were production management individuals working there. There was some kit hire from Scotland, but there was no real... It didn't stick to our economy in the way that I would have thought the quota envisaged it should.
Sorry, final point on that, just to understand what I think you're saying is that, and what David was also saying, is that the shift is about, not about the terms of the charter, the terms, it's about how BBC policy chooses to implement what's been laid out here and what's been agreed.
Yes, we occasionally hear from colleagues that a project can't be commissioned unless it's commissioned out of the Scottish pot, which requires it to be shifted to Scotland and become Scottish on a temporary basis.
Jackson.
Good morning. I think you're being very polite. It seems to me that after 10 years and a 9% target, the actual original programming making in Scotland is pathetic. And you've alluded to the kind of lift and shift notion of the BBC. And obviously the Charter is talking about trying to stimulate the creative end in Scotland. But given that we've made so little progress in so much time, have you got confidence, notwithstanding the word of the Charter, that the actual spirit that you referred to is going to find a voice in BBC Scotland? And in terms of that commissioning, if we are trying to genuinely stimulate the broadest possible cultural renaissance in Scottish broadcasting, to what extent do you feel the BBC welcomes independent production?
Thank you. You're right to identify the fact that we are trying to phrase what we're saying in acceptable language. It has been deeply frustrating over 10 years. When the 9% target was introduced, our company, which had already established relationships with commissioners and was delivering successfully to BBC Network, looked forward to a period of growth. We have seen a steady decline in the amount of network commissions that we've had ever since then, because the emphasis has been overly so on lift and shift. I would not like to say that lift and shift has been always bad. There have been career paths created within the production of Homes Under the Hammer in Scotland, where people have been able, who worked in our company, who came to us as researchers, and because we were not able to grow sufficiently quickly, they've been able to go to other companies and progress up the ladder to be series producers. And that's good. But it's not everything. And it has been deeply disappointing. You ask if we have confidence in the direction of travel. We have hope in the direction of travel, but I think it's too early to say that we have confidence.
There's a report that's been commissioned by the TV Working Group, which is a body set up to advise Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, from a company called ECOS, which shows essentially across the period from 2012 to 2015, turnover in Scotland in production has been static. It's maybe gone up or down a little bit, but it's broadly been static. Across the same period, employment's fallen by 27%. That's because, essentially, the work that is badged as Scottish remains attached to the Scottish total, but the jobs are not always in Scotland, they flow elsewhere. And that's seen an erosion of opportunity for people within Scotland. I don't know if... I have confidence. I think the BBC is genuinely trying to address these issues. I think the change in the charter, the movement to BBC Studios, the movement to 100% contestability, have made them think about how they source content. Diversity of supply is really important to them. That's become a mantra I've heard repeated back to us again and again over the last month or so. They appreciate that audiences like ideas from a lot of different sources. That's why independent producers are useful. That's why nations-based production is useful. As David said, it's democratically, economically unjustifiable to continue as they were. But it will come down to deeds, not words, effectively across the next 11 years. When the original 9% quota came in 2009, we did feel very optimistic. I started the company in 2009 on the basis that there was an opportunity here. We have had an opportunity. We have grown over that period. But I think it's fair to say, as PAC's most recent survey and the ECOS survey suggest, that the main beneficiaries of that have been the larger companies who have set up branch offices in Scotland. I'd like to see that change. It's in the BBC's gift to make that change.
Okay. You see, it's not just... The impression I have at the moment is that too much creative talent in Scotland will conclude that it has to go south because the leadership has not been in Scotland for them to be able to develop new ideas here. Now, I know, you know, new production is not just drama, which is studio intensive. There are all sorts of other forms of production, documentary, you know, lifestyle series that don't require studio capacity. And I know there is a big issue with studio capacity actually available in Scotland. But if we look at, and you mentioned this studios initiative, and I think Songs of Praise and one or two other shows have been identified as now being open to tender. Is Scotland set up to take advantage of that? I mean, it seems to me in terms of studio capacity, both Northern Ireland and Wales have been ahead of us in terms of providing the actual space which allows productions to go there. And I'm kind of aware that Invest Northern Ireland seems to be much more proactive than Scottish Enterprises in working with the independent sectors and others to actually take advantage of the opportunity. Are we set up actually even to take advantage of the new initiatives being provided under the Charter?
Am I all right? Am I on? You're right to identify the opportunities that are presented are of a scale which, you know, if you've been pitching for a three-part arts series on BBC Four, it's quite different to be pitching for a 52-week series like Songs of Praise. You know, that's a substantial increase, and there will be a continuum of BBC shows being put out. The next batch of them is due to come out in December. There'll be another batch in the new year. There's going to be a steady stream of them coming out around, I think they said, 150 hours and 250 million of stuff is due to be coming out over the next couple of years. And you're right to identify that Northern Ireland Screen has been proactive. Why? Because when you are a company of a certain size, the resources that you need to step up, not just in a sort of even organic pattern, but to make a sudden leap, may be beyond you, which is why Northern Ireland Screen has stepped in and said if any of the companies in Northern Ireland want to go after these opportunities, they will support them. We have been saying, and the Culture Committee heard it all in January, for some time, that parallel levels of partnership and engagement with the public agencies would be helpful. There are signs that there are initiatives in this direction at the moment, and when those come through, we'll be very glad.
Can I ask?
Would you like to come in on that?
In terms of studio capacity or the facilities available, in order to be able to respond to that potential opportunity, Scotland needs to be able to offer a range of spaces, from converted or pop-up space, where, for example, the Westway in Glasgow houses Robot Wars. So those sorts of spaces which have no infrastructure to speak of. Productions go in, take a short-term lease, and come out again at the end of it. That works for certain types of production. So we've got a very large amount of that. We currently market about 435,000 square feet of pop-up or alternative space. That figure compares very favourably with the other nations in the UK. You also need to have converted space, which means it is usually industrial space that has some infrastructure already in it for productions to come in, make use of, probably spend more on infrastructure as well to tailor it to the production itself. But at least there's something that's there which is continuous. We have Dumbarton Studios is a converted space. We have the Walpock Studios currently housing Outlander, which is converted space. So we would say we need more of that, but we do have a significant amount. And also in Belfast, of course, the Titanic Studios are part converted and part new purpose built. So that's how Game of Thrones works, is that it uses both those two types of space. When the Ward Park Studios expansion takes place, it would be very similar. It would have the converted space from the factory and then two new purpose-built stages. So we've got that coming up. Planning permission has been granted. And then what we all know is that Scotland lacks purpose-built studio space, so we'll have some with the Ward Park Studios when that happens. We have a studio on Stornoway where Katie Morag, the BBC Children's programme, was shot. but we need more, and we all know that there is the Pentland Studio proposal, which is currently going through planning. So with that range of options, and with what will come with Ward Park Studios, and we at Creative Scotland and the Film Studio Delivery Group are hoping very much that the Pentland Studio proposal is successful at planning, then I think, yes, we will be in a good position.
Can I ask just one final question? Thank you, everybody. And it is actually to you, Natalie, and it is Creative Scotland's role in all of this. I mean, I've associated Creative Scotland's input more at the moment or historically with film rather than with television. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I don't think many of us foresaw was the burgeoning international digital and other services, as well as the BBC, many of which are actually partnerships with the BBC now. I'm watching something called The Collection on Amazon Prime, which is, I must recommend to everybody, but it is, I think, going to make its way onto the BBC in due course, but is currently being screened internationally on digital services. But as we go forward, the opportunities for television creativity must be burgeoning. And again, if we are going to have the infrastructure and the opportunity for creative talent to take advantage of the opportunities that might now arise out of the charter, where does Creative Scotland see its role potentially in that television sector as opposed to screen?
So historically, Creative Scotland and before Scottish Screen's main source of funding is lottery funding. So, and as you know, that comes with the conditions attached to it that relate to good causes. So for the most part, our investment in through those lottery funds have been in film. However, because of the very sort of crucial role that the television sector in Scotland, and because of the size of our screen sector, we have been able to invest in TV drama using those lottery funds. So we've invested in Katie Morag, Teacup Travels, Bannon with MG Alba. And we've managed to work within that TV drama. Within certain parameters, we've focused on the development of pilots or a project to first series, but then we, because of the limits of that funding, which is a £4 million annual fund, we have felt that if a programme gets commissioned for a second series, then the market needs to take that on in terms of funding, and then we could look at other alternatives. The opportunity currently for us, we see alongside the BBC Charter renewal, is the Scottish Government's manifesto commitment to enhance the screen unit at Creative Scotland. And that's something that we're working on with our partners in government and Scottish Enterprise and other relevant agencies, because we see that if we were rather like Northern Ireland Screen, to have in one place both enterprise money and creative involvement and experience, we would be able to take charge of those opportunities and to be able to invest in that. So we would be able to invest in the wider TV market. Currently, as the lead agency for Screen, we do interact a lot with, so we sit on the TV working group, and we're able to contribute to the work with the TV sector on the basis of advocacy or influencing, but we don't have the funds to be able to support these businesses in the same way that, for example, Northern Ireland Screen can. So we're working very hard to see if we can enable that with enhanced resources in terms of money and people to be able to take advantage of the opportunities that we see at the moment.
Donald.
One thing I would perhaps add is that the sector in Scotland is very much a kill to eat kind of sector. It's based in short term commissioning for the most part. We see the benefits of the likes of Outlander getting commitments to multiple series. We know that Scotland is capable of producing, of sustaining large scale production if there is a commitment to multi year returning series. At BBC Alapa, we commit about two-thirds of our money to 3-4 year production agreements with companies. It's a sign of confidence in the companies and in the individuals who are in that sector. So not all the money is tied up in it, but a lot of it is. And I think that allows, well, I know that that allows for those companies to plan, to train, to liaise with the enterprise agencies, to borrow against making investment in capital. And so we, in a sense, are willing and want to make a commitment and show a sign of confidence in the production talent, even though sometimes we don't know exactly what that is going to give, perhaps in 3 or 4 years' time. And I think that's where we need to gradually move the whole of the sector towards, and that if the BBC were able to be the bold and creative BBC that it wants to be in Scotland, and the BBC has shown lots of intent in terms of the Open Eye player and BBC Studios of being willing to take, you know, big decisions that are aimed at making a step change. To do that in Scotland requires, I think, making longer term commitments and tying up the enterprise agencies, Creative Scotland, ourselves, in a partnership to enable that to happen over a number of years. And it needs to be, I think, movements of scale rather than, you know, a little here and a little there. They need to be pretty big, I think, to make a difference.
David?
I would agree with essentially everything Donald's just said in terms of the so-to-reap model being the current model we all follow, apart from when we're working with BBC ALPA, and your point about capacity and whether we can grow to meet the capacity if we had an increase in spend. The alternative, which is the so-to-reap model that BBC ALPA follows, helps build capacity. It concentrates investment in a number of companies who they're then able to draw in. If there's a lack of talent, we can hire people. If there's a lack of infrastructure, we can buy it. We can go to the bank, as Donald says, and hire, borrow money. I think the new charter does require the BBC to enter into partnerships, creative partnerships, for the benefit of all. Combine that with the obligation towards the nations and regions, creativity and economy. It's very useful. What we perhaps have lacked, and it has, the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament have been very useful in focusing this. The Scottish Government have provided real leadership. This committee and its predecessor have really helped us to kind of air a lot of the issues that we've been struggling with. What we've lacked potentially, actually not potentially, what we've lacked is real leadership from the public agencies. Creative Scotland, but particularly Scottish Enterprise, have been more or less missing from the field at times. But I also think you have to compare and contrast. If you go back to that 55% spend target, somebody at the BBC in Wales is doing the right thing. Somebody has really got their head screwed on the right way around. They're providing creative leadership. They're delivering a win for their whole economy. That's what I'd like to see flow from this new round of nations and regions.
Thank you. Richard Lockhead.
Thank you. In terms of David Smith's comments earlier on about the snooker being classified as Scottish spend, which was new to me until I read your evidence and heard what you said today, that sounds pretty ludicrous. And it's all because our production manager, according to your evidence, is on LinkedIn as living in Scotland. So the question then is, how do you define, or how do you recommend that we should look into this Scottish spend? I know you did touch upon this, but should there be a list of companies that are defined as, you know, being wholly Scottish or whatever, I don't know. And how do you have a situation where Scottish companies can still compete for productions elsewhere in the UK?
I think the first thing is to keep on doing what you're doing, which is provide oversight. I mean, that has really led to a lot of the evidence that's in these accounts. The previous version of this committee, the Culture Committee, as was, required that the BBC provide detail on specifically Scottish spend. And that's really allowed us to look a lot more clearly at what is and isn't happening and undercut a lot of the arguments that were previously presented at other committees. I think I go back to my early point about this continuum of what is and what is not Scottish. It's very hard to define. And I think the BBC could, without too much effort in terms of how you refocus definitions, move to an authentic model of commissioning. That would be the first step. There is an Ofcom definition which requires a substantive base, which is the two desks and Pacific Quay in the case of the snooker. Which is clearly not substantive in any meaningful way. I think if that test was more rigidly applied, that would be useful. Ofcom at the moment is reactive rather than proactive. If somebody sees an entry in the Out of London Register, which details every show that is badged as either Scottish or Welsh or Northern Irish, or English for that matter, if somebody sees a project in there and has a question about it, you can raise that with Ofcom, but Ofcom will not investigate. And for example, in the snooker, we did raise a question about, well, this time last year, just after publication of the previous report. We still don't have an answer as to why the snooker was able to qualify. And the question really is for the BBC, how was that able to qualify? In what way was that base substantive? Where was the spend? And it would be useful going forward if Ofcom was more proactive than reactive.
Okay. Well, maybe we have to move the Scottish border down to Sheffield, and that'll help our stats be more genuine.
Absolutely.
In terms of the programmes that we watch as a committee, I know Jackson Carlow said he watched his collection, which I've not seen, so I'll keep my eye open for that. I have watched lots of other series like Borgen and The Killing and so on and so forth, and paid attention to the resurgence of Scandinavian drama. Is there any lessons we should learn in Scotland from what's happening over there in terms of the role of the state broadcaster? Is this something that you must be debating as professionals in your arena?
We talk about it quite a lot. I think that what's interesting about it on the surface is that language is not a barrier to success. So, you know, we are already thinking about ways in which we can work better together. What it involves is a real focus in the context of drama, as you're describing, a real focus on development of that new talent and also opportunity for existing talent, writers, directors to create that next Borgen out of Scotland. And we would welcome the opportunity both through the enhancement of the Screen Unit in Creative Scotland from a resource perspective. We would then be enabled to work more closely with MG Alba or, and BBC Scotland to focus specific amounts of money together on that and to make sure that we develop that talent and those new programmes.
I think there are at least three things that we've learnt. One of them is that distinctiveness of the content that's required. We see that with Hinterland, actually, just now with the Welsh and BBC Four and All Three Media collaboration in Wales. But one of the first ones that kind of broke into this in the consciousness in the UK was The Killing, and the Americans remade it, and it rained continually in the American version. And there was something about that that it gave it a distinctive look and feel. So it didn't necessarily have to be the panoramic views and the to build on the natural assets of which Scotland has got a huge abundance, but it can build on other assets of distinctiveness as well. And language quite clearly now is not a barrier as we've found out. So that's something to build on. The second thing is, it's taken about 10 years for those things to happen. They didn't materialise. They were the result of strategic planning. They were the results of decisions taken 10 years ago to invest in training, in collaboration, in trying things out, in pilots. And there's a whole host of them have come to fruition, most recently from Iceland with Fortitude on Sky and also Trapped as well. And the third thing I would say is when you look at the end credits and the titles at the end, you'll see a whole kind of smorgasbord of contributors and partners. They have built up networks of collaborators across Scandinavia and Germany as well, so that they are primed already in their networks to invest in the right content and to locate it where it can be as distinctive as possible. And talking to the people who produced The Killing, it was really interesting that they made it work for their own domestic audience first. And so if it worked for their domestic audience and it was a story of universal appeal despite its distinctiveness for the local market, then it would cross boundaries very, very, very easily. And so all of these things suggest to me that we should take a long-term 5-10-year approach. This charter actually is a great length of time to be able to plan that so that we can envisage something, a future, if you like, in 10, 15 years' time, which is a bit different to the one now, and we should start working in collaboration and partnerships, not just with the BBC, but with the Scandinavians, with the Irish, with the Australians, New Zealand, etc.
On the way to that process, which is the tendering process that's now underway with BBC Studios coming into existence and the end of the in-house guarantee, allows the BBC to set to issue tenders. The first one in drama, I think, is Holby City. The BBC has already talked about eligibility criteria attaching to those tenders. It could be that the eligibility criteria require the movement of projects around the UK, which could be another iteration of lift and shift. But it could be used more constructively. It could require that project, if it is open to tender, it's open to tender from a consortium of producers within, some of whom are Scottish, some of whom are not necessarily quite so Scottish. And it allows for transference of skills, allows for build-up of capacity. It also comes down to commissioning, where the money sits. At the moment, there's talk of a commissioner for drama sitting within Glasgow for the BBC. That's a step forward. That commissioner will have no direct commissioning power. They'll have a report to the drama controller in London, who will have the final yes-no along with the channel controller. So shifting some spend to attach to that commission would be useful. As a factual producer, though, I would like to see that just the beginning of the process. I'd like to see factual commissioners based in Glasgow as well as drama commissioners. You know, we are a centre of excellence for factual. Let's have history, let's have documentaries, let's have arts, let's have features in daytime already in Scotland doing quite well. Let's replicate that.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. It's similar to Richard Lockhead's question about Sheffield and snooker. Last year I was told that BBC Question Time was a Scottish show. So is that an example of lift and shift, or is that still the case? Can you help clarify that?
Okay. That goes back to the continuum I mentioned earlier. Question Time is produced by Mentorn. Mentorn have invested in Scotland quite substantially over the last 5 years. They have approached it authentically. So the project was lifted and shifted to Scotland. And around that, Mentorn have built a genuine Scottish business. You know, they have senior talent based in Glasgow. The project is run from Glasgow, and they have built around that other project. So it has become a useful example of lift and shift. That's where the continuum is tricky, because there are shades of grey all the way along it. I think Mentorn, Lion, Scotland, a few others fall very much to the right end of the spectrum. They are authentically Scottish. Others, like the snooker, for example, less so. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
What's interesting about those projects and Homes Under the Hammer as well is that in order to provide that support and allow those companies to invest genuinely and remain in Scotland, they have been given substantial commitments, 3 years generally, commitments which have not been offered to the Indigenous production companies.
Thank you very much. Why do you think that is?
Who knows? It's a question of dialogue as to what's the appropriate project upon which that can happen, but I think there have been projects to which there could have been a longer-term commitment made. Okay.
Is this a supplementary, Lewis?
No, it's
I also have Stuart McMillan wanting to come in.
Thank you. Thank you. Just it follows on from the questions from Richard Lockhead. Just, it's regarding the Swedish television. I mean, apparently that's of a similar model to the BBC in terms of how it's set up. Now, I accept the point regarding companies, particularly when Richard was talking about the programmes from Denmark, that companies actually maybe commissioning things together and working in a more collaborative way. But in terms of how Swedish television operates as compared to the BBC, I mean, even though the structure appears to be similar, what would you say the main differences would be, and in terms of any lessons that there could be there for Scotland to take on?
I'm not familiar with Sweden particularly, but I've spent some time in Denmark, and it's probably a more direct comparison in that our populations are roughly equivalent. I think it's a strong domestic market is the change. You know, Denmark has, from memory, 6 or 7 public service broadcasters and a host of commercial broadcasters. They have a thriving domestic advertising sales market. They have a very strong public sector initiative into all things screen. DK and the, I can't remember what the equivalent of Creative Scotland's called.
The Danish Film Institute.
They actively invest and...
It gets 50 million euro a year from government.
Yeah. So there are direct comparisons in terms of population size. They're protected to a degree by their language, but their language is similar enough to their neighbours that they can co-produce. We are in a different position in that we sit next to London, which is a global media centre. It is a huge centre of gravity that draws a lot of talent and investment to it. The one area where that doesn't have to be the case is the BBC, which raises its money across the UK and could choose to spend it across the UK.
Thank you.
Lewis McDonald, did you want to come
in? I had another question, which was going back to a point that Donald Campbell made in introduction around the comparison and the difference between the way in which MJ Alapa operates with the BBC and the relationships that S4C enjoys in Wales. Just to understand a little more about how that, what that difference looks like, and whether a specific commitment by the BBC in terms of Gaelic language broadcasting would make a difference to the generation of programmes in Gaelic and generally in the Scottish production sector?
Well, there are two different structural arrangements for Welsh language television and Gaelic language television. For S4C, there's a separate company established by statute, which the BBC is obliged to support with 10 hours a week of BBC-made programmes. And as a result of the last licence fee settlement, also about £75 million of cash funding to S4C. For BBC Alapa, we chose a different route in 2008, and that was a route of what you might call an unincorporated joint venture. It's a BBC licensed service, but it's delivered in partnership and funded in partnership. So the staff of MG Alapa are very much involved in commissioning, scheduling, managing the media, etc. of the channel. And I suppose what the framework agreement sets out is a very clear financial settlement for Welsh and a promise of support for Gaelic television. And where we think that comes a little bit short is that we think that Gaelic television is actually a matter of policy, important policy matter for the BBC, and should be a policy commitment. And there should be a coherence, if you like, between the commitment to the Welsh channel and to the Gaelic TV channel. Every TV channel requires a minimum outage to make it work. BBC Alapa currently has 1.9 hours a day of new programmes, compares to 8 hours a day of new programmes on S4C. And without an increase in hours on BBC Alapa, it will be tough indeed to keep the current success going. So that's one way to look at it. The other way to look at it is that with additional reallocation of BBC funds into BBC Alapa, at the very least to match what the BBC does for S4C in terms of programme hours. So a 10-hour-a-week programme commitment to BBC Alapa, to match the BBC's 10-hour-a-week programme commitment to S4C, would give a huge amount of oxygen, I think, to BBC Alapa, not only of benefit to those who speak and use Gaelic, but also to the whole of the creative economy in Scotland, because BBC Alapa, believe it or not, is a hothouse of talent, and it's a huge opportunity to increase the skills base and the capacity in Scotland.
And that 10-hour, if there was such a 10-hour requirement, that would be, although the structure is different from S4C, that requirement would be compatible with the structure that you have as a joint incorporation or unincorporated enterprise. Is that a matter, like some of the things we talked about earlier, is that a matter for a policy decision by the BBC as opposed to something that needs to be built into the charter or the framework agreement?
Well, the Welsh commitment is a statutory compulsion on the BBC, and it's one that the BBC could opt to match as a matter of BBC policy, and that's where we would like the BBC to move towards.
Yeah. Is that supplementary? Right. Okay. Are you finished, Lewis?
I think that's my question.
Okay. It's an apocryphal story Michael Dobbs tells of the originator of House of Cards, who by the third season of House of Cards had sold the creative way in which his books were adapted away and wanted to have his name removed from it, and says that somebody stood to their full height at the BBC and said, if you do that, you'll never work for the BBC again. And I'm just wondering, with the eyes of the BBC on your back, do the independent sector and those giving evidence to the committee, are you entirely comfortable in being candid, given that what you would like, obviously, ultimately, is the BBC to look to the independent sector far more as a resource for creative programming? In other words, is the debate we are having constricted in any way by the fact that the big player in all of this ultimately is the BBC?
Ken McCorry said once, when that question was discussed, that the BBC is used to robust arguments and we should not feel inhibited about saying exactly what we thought. I think that we endeavour to say nothing which is not evidence-based and has a strong strategic argument behind it. And so we're not afraid of saying what we have said, and we have said it. I mean, the last time when the Culture Committee was here, I was due to be making a speech the next day, and I handed a copy of it to the Director General as he left the room, and it was a fairly robust speech. So, you know, we don't say things that we can't entirely back up, and we believe that actually that the people at the strategic level of the BBC are quite concerned about making progress in this direction. It's a question of driving that down to the implementation level. Okay. And that's where the difficulty is, because the relationships which are going to clinch the work are relationships between producers and commissioners, and those are very precious and very fragile relationships. And we have some understanding of the concerns of commissioners who have the ultimate responsibility for the spend of hundreds of millions of pounds over which they have very little control. And we understand why there has been, over the last decade, a reluctance to take risks and to move into other areas and a preference to work with people that you know and trust. But it takes that boldness and that change to deliver the numbers that we've been talking about at this committee.
David, just quickly.
Very briefly, we're a public service production company, the BBC's public service TV telly, and we wholeheartedly support the BBC as a provider of public service television. These are constructive criticisms, and I think they welcome them.
Yeah, Donald Campbell mentioned earlier that you can make very culturally distinctive television programmes that then have a universal appeal. You can sell them around the world, as the Scandinavians have shown, and I believe that Bannon's had its first international sale as well. Congratulations for that. We have talked a lot today about what you evidence-based in terms of the figures, the quotas, the jobs creative, and that's understandably absolutely key. But if I can go back to that point about cultural, something that's produced here in Scotland that's culturally distinctive as Scottish, that then has a universal appeal. People have told me that there is an attitude within the BBC that, yeah, particularly in terms of network, that they won't commission those culturally distinctive programmes because they don't think that, not just that they'll have an international appeal, but a UK-wide appeal. And I wondered if that is something that you would care to reflect on. I realise that you're not drama producers, you're factual producers, but have you perceived that attitude at BBC network level?
Colin Cameron used to say that he was very frustrated when he suggested that there should be, for instance, something significant about child abuse in Orkney. That was regarded as a little local difficulty, but when it happened in Cleveland, it was of national importance. I think that is something that we suffer from. If you listen to James Robertson's wonderful little clip from his book 365, The News Where You Are, the news where you are is not news where we are, you know, that sort of thing. That is a cultural issue that the BBC is going to have to deal with all over the place. And in some respects, it's about, its problem is partly Scotland, but it's partly the South East, which has been used to thinking that everything that it is concerned about is of national significance, and anything beyond the South East is trivial.
I think representation's important, but potentially a trap. I think that if you know, as a producer of public service content, you know, probably our most critically acclaimed film last year was about Ted Hughes, who's in no way Scottish and only tenuously connected. We want to make representational content, but we don't want to just make representational content. You know, we want to make Lewis Grassett Gibbon and Shakespeare, all of those things. I think you have to be careful not to be too tightly hemmed in by that.
I think it's incumbent on commissioners and programme makers to know exactly who their audience is going to be as well. So sometimes the cultural distinctiveness is the thing that's really going to sell. So when you know that, I think you can build up a really strong offering that crosses borders. So if we're commissioning for BBC Alapa, we need to be clear about whether this is a programme that's only ever going to be seen by BBC Alapa audiences, or whether it's something that we would envisage being seen across the UK or even internationally. And a good example of that might be the programme that Solace TV Productions made about Alexander McQueen, which was recently shown at the Madrid Fashion Festival in Spanish, so dubbed across into Spanish. So some things do travel particularly well, and others won't. You just need to be clever enough at the outset to know what it is that it's going to, you know, who your audience is and who your market is.
Okay. I think you had a supplementary, Stuart.
Yes, no, thank you. Just the commissioning of programmes is one aspect, so in terms of Scotland. And I think, Mr. Campbell, I think your point there kind of leans on to the supplementary. It's not just about the commissioning, but it's about the promotion of programmes that do come from Scotland. Do you think there is enough promotion of Scottish programmes and Scottish-made programmes across the network and elsewhere via the BBC?
My personal view is not at all. I think the BBC brand and the Scotland brand are hugely underdeveloped in combination, both within the UK and within the international marketplace. So I don't think we've even tapped into the potential of that.
Okay. Unfortunately, we're going to have to wind up. This is obviously a session scrutinising the Charter. Now, you've been very eloquent and concise in what you see the problem is in Scotland, and you've all said that this is a problem that can be identified and addressed by BBC management without necessarily the Charter forcing that on them. But is there anything that you would like to see? Is there any way that the Charter could be changed that would deliver your objectives for you?
Now about the service agreement, more than the Charter. I think actually changing the wording of the Charter now would be all but impossible. But there's really useful language within that Charter that the service agreement can then build upon. You know, like the public purpose about commissioning and investing in the creative economies of each of the nations. You know, that's a clear public purpose that the BBC now has to deliver. How it delivers it will be framed within the service agreement, and how that's monitored is up to this Parliament, the Westminster Parliament, and the governments in both places.
Yeah. And scrutiny of the annual work plans and then the work of Ofcom to review those each year is going to be the opportunity to ensure that that public purpose is delivered.
And I think the dialogue between Ofcom and the BBC and the rest of us becomes critically important in setting the standards and the performance measures that will be put in place in the new service agreements. Yeah. And it's important that there's an opportunity for consultation in that process.
Okay.
I think that's vital. This committee has an opportunity to look at the service agreement before it's finalised.
Point taken. Thank you very much for coming to give evidence to us today, and we'll now have a short adjournment before moving to the next panel. Hello, I'd like to welcome to the meeting our second panel, Anne Bulford, Deputy General, Director General of the BBC, Alan Dixon, Chief Operating Officer of BBC Scotland, Ken Macquarie, Director of BBC Scotland, and Bill Matthews, the BBC Trustee for Scotland. And before I move to members' questions, I'd like to give Anne Bulford the opportunity to make some opening remarks.
Good morning, and thank you, Convener, for inviting us here today and giving us the opportunity to discuss with the committee some of the key issues around drama, around charter and the likely impact here in Scotland. When the Director General and I were here, along with Kenny, in January, we discussed a number of charter proposals that both underpin the BBC's commitment to Scotland and support real positive and lasting change in the country's broadcast sector. Before we turn to that, I'd like firstly to start by saying how very much we welcome the proposals within the draft charter and the clear and stable basis for production that comes with the guarantee of licence fee funding. We're also pleased that there's been some movement around proposed appointments to the BBC's unitary board, which should provide an appropriate distance between the broadcaster and the governments of the UK. Over the past few months, we've been working hard to develop many of the proposals around the charter for our audiences in Scotland and across our offer for the UK's nations and regions. Work continues apace, for example, on developing the Scottish digital editions of our homepages in news and in sport, and as discussed by the Director General when he appeared here at the previous committee. That committee's report called for the BBC to provide detailed financial information about our operations and spend in Scotland. And from the last session and from looking at the accounts, you'll all be aware that we've made a number of submissions to the previous committee and have since, for the first time, laid before the Scottish Parliament our annual report and accounts. Further, as recommended by the committee, a commitment by the BBC to appear at the relevant Scottish Parliamentary committees is contained within the draft charter, as is the committee's recommendation that the length of the charter be adjusted to make further future scrutiny of the charter process unaffected by the electoral cycle. The committee also sought a strong Scottish element in the regulatory framework, and the draft charter ensures that a non-executive director for Scotland will sit on the BBC's new unitary board. And in terms of the committee's calls for increased commissioning power in Scotland, we've already announced a new drama commissioner and a new comedy commissioner for Scotland. A drama development fund will be set up, and Scotland will be identified as a centre of excellence for the BBC in factual production. And I would like to stress that this is not a definitive list. This is progress to date. I'm very aware that time is tight, so I'd only like to make one more observation, if I may, and that is to put on public record just delighted we are across the BBC that my colleague Ken Macquarie has been appointed as the new BBC Director of Nations and Regions. It is an excellent appointment for Scotland, for the nations and for the BBC, and above all, I believe, for audiences, for I know that Kenny's focus in that role will be entirely on ensuring that audiences, particularly those in the nations and regions, remain at the heart of our thinking in the years that lie ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And I would like to open up by congratulating Mr. Macquarie on his appointment. You'll have heard some of the evidence that we've just taken. By far the key complaint is the amount of licence payers' money that's spent here in Scotland. In Scotland, we uniquely received just 55% of licence fee revenue. Now, that compares to 74% in Northern Ireland, and we heard today that in Wales it's above 90%. You have presided over that, Mr. Macquarie, in Scotland. You have presided over that failure in Scotland. And we've heard today that's a failure of management. It's not to do with the framework. How are you going to address that now that you have this even more elevated position as Director of Nations and Regions?
Thank you, Convener. I do not regard it as a failure of management. I think the figures are dynamic and they have changed from year to year. And we saw when in 2014, where we had a considerable investment in Scotland, that these figures were high. Admittedly, the figures have fallen relative to the licence fee collected in Scotland. But the comparison with Wales, there are very specific circumstances in relation to comparing with Wales that I think it would be useful to take the committee through. In terms of where we get to, the key thing for us is to make the fourth purpose of the Charter absolutely live and breathe. And the Director General is committed to that being one of the top important issues for the BBC, thus the appointment of the Director of Nations and Regions. So clearly, in terms of the investment that comes out of Scotland, if we look over the last 5 years, we've had 8.9% of the eligible spend in terms of meeting our targets. And that has been since over the last 7 years, we've tripled the amount of money spent in Scotland. It's a considerable, and that's tens of millions of pounds. It's a considerable achievement under what we refer to as the Network Strategy Review. The specific comparator, whether you're dealing with different fundings in terms of the languages in Wales, and also a set up in terms of which has been funded by a number of partners in Rothlock, you know, which has provided a base for drama, I think is probably not the, it's not the only lens that we should look at here. The key thing for us is, first of all, just to understand what underpins these figures. Specifically to Wales, I just asked my colleague, Chief Operating Officer Alan Dixon, just to make a number of points just as to what the breakdown on these figures is.
Thanks, Kenny, and thanks, Convener. Kenny's kind of looked at a comparison between Wales and Scotland, and I think it is important maybe just to inform the committee of the three major drivers of spend in Scotland and Wales. The first one would be on English language content across all services, and that's broadly similar. It's around 30% of the licence fee take in both countries. The next element, I guess, would be network TV production, and it's fair to say that Wales had a fantastically strong year in 15-16, and I think in Scotland that's been challenging. We fully expect that to increase, though, in 16-17. And the last element, I guess, of what any level of spend happens in Scotland and Wales relates to Indigenous language provision. And in Scotland, that amounts to 3% of the licence fee take. In Wales, it's 23%. So I guess there are specific reasons, Anne, about why that is the case, some historical, some related to the level of speakers in those areas. But those are the three main economic drivers about how much the BBC spends in each of the three nations.
Well, that's all very well, but we, you know, it's there in black and white that in Northern Ireland it's 74% compared to 55%. So it's not just about the comparing with Wales. Northern Ireland spends considerably above ours as well.
What I would say to that, Convener, is again, if we look at the spend on content, English language content in Scotland and Northern Ireland, it's maybe slightly more in Northern Ireland. But I guess there's economies of scale of setting up a base and a production base in Northern Ireland that would be included in those numbers. Kenny's right in terms of the nature of this is not a static number. Last year, the equivalent figure for Scotland was 63%, so higher simply because of the level of network TV business and spend we had in Scotland. The annual accounts and make it quite clear in terms of some of the reasons about why that dip and expenditure has happened related to the decommissioning of Waterloo Road and some of our other titles. But we've recognised that and we've done something about it. And we believe that this year, when you look at the network levels of spend, they'll return to a level much closer to those in 14-15, an increase of 20 million. And that's driven by drama titles. So we've got some impressive stuff happening in terms of One of Us, that's there, Shetland, the next series of Shetland will be there as well. So it's a difficult situation to manage when you lose a returning series like Waterloo Road. But I think we've made a good recovery from that and we'll continue to do that in drama. And we're hopeful that the announcement about a drama commissioner in Scotland as well will help that situation. So I wouldn't see it as a static figure. It is something that moves. And one of the main drivers is around network TV spend, which happens in any one year. And although we have broad targets, they are ultimately dependent on the quality of ideas that are coming through in any one year, and in some cases the transmission patterns.
Not just, you've explained that what you see your interpretation of the figures as being, but we've got lots of evidence from right across the sector. It's not just this committee, previous committees, the Economy Committee, who have been very, very critical about the way things operate and the amount of money that's spent in Scotland, but also the way it's spent and the lift and shift culture that we've heard about in our first audience session, which, for example, Snooker from Sheffield's classified as a Scottish programme for these accounting purposes. Do you agree that that's just not good enough?
I think you have to look at what's been achieved in terms of the network strategy review over the period, and as I said, a tripling of the spend in that period. I'm reluctant to get to speak specifically about a specific company, because obviously we liaise directly with PACT. We've heard evidence from David and David representing their two companies today, and as they said, I've encouraged them to be robust in their critique, of the BBC for us to indulge, to engage in an open debate. I think that where you get in, what we're dealing with are the Ofcom criteria, and we have a number of assurances and processes whereby we ensure that we are having dialogue with the companies in terms of the spend. But the thing to focus on is the tens of millions of pounds over the period. There's been a lot of focus on one specific company, but as was evident from one of the examples that was given, many of the companies that have started with a production have now offering substantial employment opportunity in Scotland, but also winning very large commissions across the genres. And you heard about the example of one of them there today. So overall, network strategy review, and I think that my colleagues in the independent sector, whatever their critiques of individual titles might be, has been an absolute success for Scotland, both in driving the skills base and also increasing the opportunities available. To your point earlier, convener, as to what we should do in terms of increasing the spend, I think the Deputy Director General has mentioned a number of the commissioners that we have in place. We will be announcing further commissioning roles in Scotland, but also looking at development spend in order to seed and develop the industry. And we have an ongoing dialogue with Creative Scotland. We're absolutely open to partnering.
Right. Well, we've heard that, employment fell by 27% between 2012 and 2015. But from what you're saying, you don't seem to accept that there's a serious problem. Does that mean that you can't give us any kind of guarantee that over the next charter period that more percentage of the licence fee will be spent more equitably across the nations and regions, and particularly in Scotland?
I think when we came in January, we spoke about this. And our view, we welcome the sixth purpose, and our collective view across the whole board, there's no disagreement on this, is that it's very, very important that as a national broadcaster across the UK, that we both represent that UK, we reach out to all audiences, and at the same time we make a contribution to the creative economy around the UK. And I think Kenny has described very well that in the last charter period, there was a clear objective to move the focus of spend out of London and to move the focus of network spend out into the nations. And we set specific targets on that, which we've met consistently through the period. I think the challenge of the next charter is to build on that and to develop that further. And we are investing in commissioners here in Scotland, and we are investing in development to bring on new ideas and encourage new talent. And we also need to focus even more on the issue of portrayal. But I think as one of the witnesses in the previous session, I think he made the point very well, we don't want that to somehow be constraining. So we want producers in Scotland to have opportunities to bring forward great ideas as well as representing the Scottish nation.
Okay, Ross Greer.
Thanks, Peter. As you've heard in the previous session, there was a discussion of lift and shift and where examples can be positive as well as negative. So Mentorn was cited as a specific example of a company that was attracted to Scotland and has proven very successful and good for the industry in Scotland. But the issue that came out of it was that companies being attracted to Scotland are being offered long-term commitments where Indigenous production companies are not. I was wondering if you could explain why that's the case and how that can be corrected to ensure that the talent, the resources, the companies that are already here are getting these kind of opportunities.
I think that the nature of a commissioning contract and the term of it, the length of it, the number of episodes, the money attached to it, will all depend on the individual project and the clear line of sight that the commission will have on their competence in that project in terms of its likely success. The term, therefore, that they're able, the place they see for it in the schedule and the term that they're likely to want it for, as well as economic questions about whether you can get more economy of scale out for a longer run rather than a shorter run. There's always a particular issue with children's programmes where they tend to have longer runs because with children's drama, with the young people in it, it's difficult to get continuity through, for example. I'm not aware of, I have never seen any evidence of a bias in length of commission or commissioning terms between individual companies. And if there is evidence of that, of course, we'll look at it. I think it's very much driven by the nature of the commissions, the titles concerned. And of course, if I don't like this phrase lift and shift, but it's the phrase we're using here in the committee, so we'll stick with it. If of course you're looking at an established title, it's much easier to give a longer term commitment.
Just to make a quick point, Mr. Greer, I think I heard from Donald talking about kind of ideas of scale, which would help the sector, and also Rosina, unfortunately I missed the start of the session, but PACT have produced some really strong work about the sector in Scotland and what we can do to improve that situation. One of their concerns, which I think you're alluding to, is around sustainability of supply. And we've certainly got some very, very strong plans, which we hope to share quite quickly, which we think will start to address maybe some of the concerns about some of the smaller Indigenous companies in Scotland. The term factual centre of excellence is an interesting one because I think within the BBC we have a very strong blueprint of and an example of where that works well. If you only have to look at Cardiff and Rothlock and the level of drama that's happening there, but the key thing there is that returning series are being delivered. So that's something that we're really, really passionate about making happen in Scotland. How do you achieve that? You achieve it certainly by looking at the levers of commissioning power and seeing exactly when and where they should be devolved. You achieve it by working, I would say, even more proactively with all the agencies in Scotland to achieve that. And also what's important would be development funds and development funds that might be targeted specifically at those types of company. I'm also glad David Smith mentioned some of the changes that we hope to bring in terms of new contestability arrangements and how we put commissions out for tender, because I think the ability to specify where we want production to happen from, I think will be something that benefits us in Scotland.
Thanks very much. And I take on absolutely the point around the individual project mattering. Obviously, in the case of Mentorn and Question Time, it's safe to go for a long-term commitment with a programme like Question Time. But I think the fact that it was mentioned goes back to a point that was raised earlier in that session, in the spirit versus the rule of the agreements. An issue of broader confidence that production companies in Scotland have with the BBC. How are you going to address the issue of confidence, not just through written agreement, but the relationship that you have with these companies? Because for it to even come up strikes me as there being an issue of confidence.
I think that the first thing to speak about is the quality of the relationships and the way in which both commissioners based outside of Scotland and the teams that are based in Pacific Quay reach out, explain opportunities to the sector, explain opportunities to secure development money and work closely with talent. And I think that that is something we do a lot of, we need to do more of, and having more established commissioning base in Pacific Quay will help with that. I think the second thing is in terms of the definitions, it's just to be completely clear, the definitions that we use for qualifying independence, for qualifying for out of London, are the definitions that are used across the whole sector, have been in place, I think, since the early 2000s. And they have a series of decision points on them. A substantial base, usual place of employment for senior personnel managing the business, 70% of the production budget, excluding on-screen talent, archive and copyright, to be spent in the region, and more than 50% of production talent. That those are long established, and they're used across the whole industry, and sometimes they work very well and very easily, and sometimes they don't. And I think it's our job to be transparent about it, to put the report into Ofcom in the normal way, which we do, and when questions arise, to seek to answer them. So I don't want to comment further on this the specific title that was raised, because the previous witnesses explained, they've put a question into Ofcom and they wait for Ofcom to answer that. But I think at heart, it's about the personal relationships and feeling that that's leading to success and great creative content is coming through from Scotland, and everybody wants that. So investing in development, investing in the commissioning base and spending time on the relationships is designed to bring that through.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton. I had a supplementary, convener, on the previous question. We've heard evidence today from Creative Scotland and the types of resource, facility and support that they need to succeed. Can you be more specific about the contribution investment that you will give to Creative Scotland?
Well, I think in terms of the investment, it tends to be project, you know, it tends to be project based, you know, with at the moment with Creative Scotland, but what we do seek out, we have a memorandum of understanding with Creative Scotland in terms of ensuring that we work together, we respond to an initiative that they may be developing. We often respond very positively to that, and I think that where we want to get to is a longer term approach, perhaps more similar to Northern Ireland Screen, which has a specificity about it. I think that's one of the things that we could move to. And there's a great will in Creative Scotland, you know, to do so. I think the other point, to on Mr. Greer's point, just about the trust and the relationship, very good relationship between our commissioners and PACT, both locally and at UK level, and that's been particularly in the light of the recent meetings we've had and where we've made and where we've been open as to where we're tendering and what new opportunities are, which are considerable for the independent sector in Scotland, and I think that's about and I think the dialogue, although robust, has been, I regard it, has been good and open.
I would maybe just make a quick point, if it's okay, just on listen to Natalie Usher mentioning the relationship with Scottish, with Northern Ireland Screen and the BBC. And again, that's an example where I think it's right and proper that we look at that relationship within the BBC to see how well that works and see exactly what issues and what learnings and what themes we can take it into a future and a more improved relationship, one that's more productive with Creative Scotland. And I think that and that has come about in Northern Ireland by a lot of hard work and investment on our side as well. And I don't see any reasons why, if that was a direction of policy within Scotland, that we couldn't and wouldn't want to contribute fully to developing that further.
Do you want to come in?
I was just gonna take us back around to the Charter. And as a member of the BBC Trust, who of course are part of the governance mechanism going forward, I'm really pleased to see the proposed charter hardwires some of the things that we're talking about here. And as I think earlier contributors said, it gives us a platform which I think writes in a duty of partnership for the BBC, which I think speaks to the last point that was just made. And it's a charter which has more references to nations and regions and effort and energy towards doing more in the nations and regions than we've ever seen in a BBC charter before. So that has to be a good thing on behalf of audiences in Scotland.
Thank you very much. And I've got Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much. Just a couple of things arising from the previous evidence session that would be, I think, of interest. There was some discussion around MG Alibi and the difference between the approach to Gaelic language broadcasting, which is on the basis of a joint unincorporated venture, and the statutory position that underpins the position of S4C. And I think the answer to the question was essentially there's no need to replicate the statutory provision. What is required is a policy approach. And I think we heard from Alan Dixon earlier on that the big difference between spend in Scotland and spend in Wales, the largest single item of that is the difference in language broadcasting. I wonder, I know it's an area close to the heart of Ken Macquarie as well, but I wonder what the approach will now be from the board, the BBC across the UK, to the question of Gaelic language broadcasting. Is there an opportunity here to build in the same level of programme making for Gaelic in Scotland as is enjoyed by Welsh in Wales? And what are the potential benefits of that for the wider production sector in Scotland?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that I'm extraordinarily proud of what BBC Alibi has achieved, and I have a stake in that. I was probably one of the most important voices in arguing for the setting up of BBC Alibi, and I'm delighted that in the last charter it is the one new channel that we were able to deliver in Scotland, and I'm also delighted by the success that it's had. And Alan, a colleague, sits on the joint management board with Donald, etc. And there, it's an example of a really good partnership between the BBC. Specifically, there are different lifestyle stages, if you like, in terms of where BBC Alibi is and where S4C has been over a 25-year period. S4C has been in existence and it's had as Donald mentioned, it's had legislative underpinning, statutory underpinning in that regard. On the point of policy, we've already been active in doing things as far as policy, where we have, within our available funds, made increases in the investment to BBC Alibi. And just ask Alan just to describe in detail that.
Yeah, Kenny, as you rightly say, privileged to sit in the joint management board of BBC Alibi. It's a fantastically creative partnership between ourselves and MG Alibi, and Donald described some of that very well this morning. And what I would say on the BBC side, though, it's not just words. We have backed it up financially very recently. So in this current financial year, we'll increase funding, direct funding, into the channel of 0.9 million, rising to 1.2 million in 17-18. So that's a 20% increase in the funding that the BBC puts in directly. But that's only one aspect of what I think the BBC can still bring to this partnership. I think we can and will bring more. There's something about kind of leveraging some of the ideas around, brilliant ideas of programming, which happens right across the BBC, and just making sure that Gaelic is a discussion that happens much earlier in those commissioning decisions about children's content and various other genres, so that that can pass across and be available to the channel and BBC Alibi. And I know the head of service, Margaret Mary Murray, is doing some work on that front as well. Where we can share costs, we will. So certainly, in terms of my involvement with the Joint Management Board, it's continually trying to look at ways in which we can bring more to that partnership and ultimately free up money that can go on screen.
I think just looking at the total resources of the BBC, and iPlayer is a very good example where, if you like, a pan-BBC investment allowed, you know, BBC Alibi and its audiences to have a really, really rich service, in many ways perhaps the richest service in terms of language that iPlayer offers. And that is something we're really proud of. But also just in terms of the leadership of Margaret Mary Murray, who Alan mentioned, you know, she's been a tremendous leader of the service. really proud of what she's achieved, and I'll be on Friday, I'll be in Stornoway with the Director General talking to the teams, you know, and I've no doubt the issue will come up again.
Thank you very much.
Richard Lockhead and then Jackson Carlow.
Thank you for giving evidence today. I'm just trying to work out, given all the political developments that have taken place in Scotland over the last decade or so, Scotland's desire to be represented, for decisions to be taken closer to home, two Scotland bills through that have given more powers to the Scottish Parliament with the referendum in 2014. So it's been quite an eventful decade for Scotland, and I'd like to ask Anne Bulford, why is it we're here in 2016 discussing the fact, against that backdrop, that due to the slow pace of devolution within the BBC, only 55% of licensed payers' money is actually spent in this country?
There's never going to be an equal arithmetic money from one part of the United Kingdom spent evenly in another part of the United Kingdom because our services are national services, and some of the spend, a significant part of the spend, is spent on services for everybody. So, for example, sports rights are negotiated for the networks, as opposed to sports rights for BBC Scotland services, are negotiated centrally, paid for centrally. Distribution contracts are handled and paid for in one place. Much of the core news gathering effort, including the World Service, is dealt with for the whole. We're very clear that we don't think 55% is enough, having set all that to one side. It's disappointing that the proportion of spend in Scotland has reduced. This financial year is reported in the accounts that we published in spring versus the previous year. We're encouraged that we see that increasing back up in 16-17, and that's by no means a cap. We are broadcaster across the United Kingdom, and we want creative contribution from across the United Kingdom because of the benefits that spreads and because of the requirement to represent programming. So it will come up, it will come up more. It is unlikely that it's going to be pound for pound. And in this context, I think it's worth remembering that almost 90% of consumption of BBC services from Scottish audiences is for network services, which have that rich range of spread with all the things which are available to all, including the Olympics and the football.
Given that the previous witnesses clearly were putting a lot of emphasis on the need for more expenditure in Scotland to create a critical mass of talent and companies involved in production and everything else to do with the television and film sector, can you give the committee an assurance that 55% is going to be history, and that, you know, with the changes proposed, you believe they're strong enough? Because I think there's a lot of doubt around the table, clearly, and certainly from the Scottish Government, that we're going to be substantially greater in terms of the percentage of Scottish licence payer money actually spent in this country developing talent and producing our message for the rest of the world, be that via news or drama or whatever it may be.
The percentage of network spend, the percentage of content spend on network television is what has been used historically and will be used, I'm sure, over the next number of years to drive that creative base in Scotland. We have said that we expect to see that proportion increase in the current year that we're in. And we are putting direct effort into building that base further in Scotland. So that network spend should increase. The pattern of BBC spending as we go through the 11-year charter will change, and the mix of money which goes on, for example, digital distribution versus others, so that kind of core infrastructure which everybody benefits, where the checks are written from wherever they're written from, may shift, but that network spend on content should increase. The other thing I do think it's worth going back to is that opening up the whole of the production-based competition over the course of the charter and setting aside the in-house guarantee and opening up returning series. We saw the first batch put to the market last week, will offer real opportunity for the whole of the independent sector, including Scotland, and people will have the opportunity to bid for these fixed titles in the schedule, which audiences know and love. But of course, it is a constraint on opportunity unless those are put out to market.
What would you like expenditure to get to in terms of percentages? I know you can't give a precise percentage, but for the reasons you've explained, but you've said that 55% is unacceptable, and given we need to give an assurance and some continuity to the media industry in Scotland and all the businesses who benefit, what do you think would be a reasonable figure?
Well, I'm going to be considerably more encouraged seeing it go up by the 20 million that we see this year. Then we will need to look at what is a helpful landmark in the future as we do two things: build the content plan across the whole of the BBC and the service licences, and look at the service licences for Scotland and work that up. So I think it's hard to see that any part is going to hit a complete arithmetic match, but I'm going to be considerably more encouraged to see it at what were peak levels actually in 13-14 and come back much closer to that.
Jackson Connell.
Thank you. Sorry, I hope I'm not going to be circular in some of this, but can I go back? Am I right in thinking that the new position of Director of Nations and Regions is in fact a new position? There isn't a current occupant of that post.
That's right.
That's right. And in, therefore, having identified the need for this new post, can I understand from your perspective what the problem is that you think the appointment of this position is set to resolve, and what levels of authority Ken Macquarie will have in this position to actually affect the change that you believe this position has been put in place to deliver?
I think that Kenny may want to comment on this as well. I think the Director General was very clear when he announced the post that he wanted a weight of focus around the boardroom table to ensure that alongside the individual services and the individual network services and alongside the core infrastructure of the BBC, much of which I'm responsible for, that at the in the leadership team reporting directly to him, there was a person in a position to really represent the voices of the licence fee payers and to ensure that many of the issues that we've been discussing today remain in focus, remain on the agenda and are turned to. It also, of course, is the person who will oversee the operation of the way in which the services around the UK run and are managed and ensure that we get best opportunity to share ideas and share experience and make sure that good things done in one part of the United Kingdom are reflected elsewhere. So it's a role which spreads across the nations and regions of England, and it's a role of considerable weight and authority at the table. Kenny, did you want to add?
Just to echo that it's important, first of all, as I said earlier, delivering the fourth purpose in terms of how we invest in nations and regions and in the creative economy of these nations is absolutely at the top of the Director General's priorities. This role will on a weekly and daily basis drive the importance of that. I think that it will be supported by the totality of the BBC in terms of drawing resources, whether that's from marketing, whether that's from research across the whole organisation, and I feel that in terms of the potential that we have within the nations and regions in terms of talent, there's a huge opportunity for us to use that talent both between the nations and taking good lessons from one nation to another, but also to the whole of the BBC. And that's the Director General's view, is absolutely, and he's made that commitment in the letters that he sent to the Scottish Government, specifically about Scotland, but it goes for the whole of the UK.
Well, I mean, can I say I unreservedly welcome the appointment? I think that it does, I hope, give hope to the confidence that we're trying to see. I was very struck by a phrase you used at the beginning of the evidence session when you said the core purpose of the Charter is to live and breathe the spirit, I think was what you said. And it's that essence that I think, I imagine when the last Charter was awarded, some might have said the same, but and it wasn't said in any maliciously critical way, but the suggestion was given that the safe option is the option that some have fallen back on in coming up with the 9% or the achievement of the 9% of original programming target, because that was easier than potentially taking a risk. Now, you've identified the appointment of a new drama commissioner in Scotland. You've talked potentially about other commissioners. Earlier in the evidence, we heard that they won't actually have a budget to spend. They'll still have to go through somebody who is at a higher level of a commissioning base still. And so, going back to you were saying the core purpose of the Charter is to live and breathe it, that you yourself have got this position of nations and regions. What is it you, what actions can you point to that are in your mind that might lead to the delivery this time round of the objectives that we're trying to see achieved, as opposed to the letter of them being something people look to do rather than the spirit?
Well, I think I am, as I said earlier, proud of what's been achieved in the last Charter, whether it's BBC ALLAP or whether it's the tripling of the spend. And I absolutely, as I take the criticism that's been offered in an open spirit, and that there are areas where we have to do better, and specifically the areas in which I think that we need a focus is firstly in drama, because of the volume of spend, the cost per hour of drama tends to drive your overall spend, but also it has, if you like, iconic or emblematic status for audiences, and I think we can see that from the success of Shetland, from One of Us, and also the other area particularly important in terms of winning young audiences is comedy, because one of the areas that this next Charter will be looking at is to ensure that we're providing for all audiences, but specifically I think we need to provide more for young audiences, and comedy either in a digital form or in the straightforward channel form, and often it can be both, is one of the genres that can deliver both a high cost per hour but also a real mass appeal for audiences. And we've got a great slate of comedy coming up from Scotland specifically between now and Christmas, which are really some notable commissioning successes in that regard. The development spend, I think, is important that the commissioners have been able to seed ideas, to encourage ideas. And I think the way that commissioning works, essentially, you have to have a channel schedule in place, so there's a channel controller. You need the assent of the channel controller, even if the overall head of genre commissioning wants to do it, because you're trying to make the best possible offer to all audiences. So it's a complex set of decisions, but ultimately the benefit of having a commissioner on the ground is, one, the development spend, the relationship and the trust that they have with either the independent sector or BBC Studios, as will be, and their ability to deliver the content. And where that works well, you tend, despite the fact they may not have the total devolved budget, you tend to find high levels of trust between the individuals working in that sector. So I'm both optimistic and confident that we'll see real returns from that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Emma Harper, did you have a question?
Yeah, thanks very much. We've talked a lot about drama and comedy commissioners and putting money into, you know, drama TV. I'm interested in news, for instance. In the draft Charter, it says the public purpose is to provide impartial news and information to help people understand and engage with the world around them. So I'm wondering if there's a proposed self-monitoring process to check whether there is an impartial news, and if there was evidence demonstrating an absence or lack of impartiality, would there be a strategy to act on it?
First of all, certainly we will measure, you know, against our impartiality on a number of issues we have done in the past, and the trust, you know, taking a number of reports in that regard. So giving news that are independent, that a news service that's independent, impartial, is absolutely at the bedrock of this charter. That's something we'll absolutely pay close attention to. So it's one of the most important deliveries for the public service broadcaster.
I sit on the editorial standards committee of the BBC Trust, which is the final stage of any complaints process on matters of impartiality or accuracy, fairness. And we've worked very hard, put a lot of effort into reactively and proactively dealing with impartiality matters. And it's a wide spectrum. Most recently, we published a report on how the BBC presents statistics, which I think was pretty well received, and looked at things that the BBC did well and the BBC could do better. That's an example of the kind of work that has gone on under the auspices of the Trust. Obviously, in the new governance mechanism, Ofcom will ultimately be the regulator of the BBC, so there will be a process that will replicate the editorial standards that currently are regulated by the BBC Trust.
Do you have another question? You finished?
Yeah, no, that's fine, thanks.
Okay, we're fast running out of time. Can I just finish up by just pressing Anne Bulford again on this issue of the 55%? If 55% is unacceptable, what is acceptable in your view? Is it 74% like Northern Ireland, or are we going to get it above 90%? What is the target?
There is no target at present. I think that, as we've tried to explain, there's a structural difference between Scotland and Wales coming through from the commitments to S4C.
Sorry to interrupt, but I have already heard that already from Mr. Dixon.
Yes.
I want to know, I don't want to know all about the past, I want to know about the future, I want to know what your commitment is.
The commitment is to continue to work with BBC Scotland to build the share of network commissioning. We previously set a target, which was to ensure that 8.6% of network commissioning came from Scotland, and we've worked towards that and achieved that. When we come to set the service licences and the content plan, we will revisit those targets. We haven't yet done that.
But as we've heard...
It's the network commissioning which is the substantial opportunity to increase that percentage.
Yeah. And it's the network commissioning also which has, as we've heard, this committee has heard, previous committees have heard, has failed to be robust in insisting that the production that's commissioned is recognised that it is Scottish in terms both economically and creatively. We've heard that. How are you going to ensure that this target is met by production companies based in Scotland, authentically Scottish, employing Scottish people, telling Scottish stories, if you like?
We will continue to operate within the rules as they are. We will continue to look to the spirit of that to build a creative base in Scotland and to build it further. Over the course of the last charter, we have substantially grown, tripled the network spend in Scotland. We've brought very many jobs to Scotland and we've brought through some brilliant programming which audiences know and love. We've talked throughout about the way in which out of London and independent definitions are monitored and managed. And to change that in some way and to make judgments about whether the shareholders are sufficiently Cornish or sufficiently Welsh is a very, very difficult set of judgments. And there may be difficulties, as the previous witnesses explained, about a spectrum. But the advantage of the current definitions are they are used across the whole industry, across the whole of the UK.
And it's not satisfying people. It's not about saying how sufficiently Cornish or Scottish someone is. It's clearly it's about the content being produced here and emanating from Scotland, which obviously the programme, the snooker programme from Sheffield is a good example, but there are many other examples, and it's not just this committee that's heard it, it's previous committees that have heard it. The sector talks about it continuously. It's seen as a failing, and the figures suggest that there is a real failing, and I don't think anything that you've said here today, Mrs. Bulford, has actually given us any real reassurance that the BBC at managerial level is going to change.
I think I'm disappointed if that's the case, because I think we've tried throughout the hearing to explain the commitment that we have enshrined in the Charter to build creative industries around the UK. We've spoken about the way in which we're investing in Scotland, and we have set out the shared ambition to build that base here. It is not the case that there is no strong Scottish programming coming through from the network commissioning from here. Shetland seems to me to be a wonderful example of a programme commissioned from Scotland, which is representative of a community which has a universal appeal. And there are many more titles on the list that also meet that criteria. But it's also the case that producers in Scotland can make programming which is from a broader base and not necessarily specific to Scottish culture.
Supplementary.
Yeah, thanks. The question that was discussed in the previous session came around to in addressing, for example, how successful Scandinavian television programme making had been recently. Some of the answers around that were that training and collaboration and planning over a 10-year period had produced this upsurge of very high quality programming that was exportable and creative. Would the BBC, would your view be to agree that the 11-year window that we have here creates an opportunity to do that in this current charter period, and will that address some of the questions that have been raised about
I think production? It does. I think the length of the charter period and the security that comes from agreeing the licence fee mechanic through that period is extremely encouraging and gives a great base to plan and to build partnerships and to work with organisations like Creative Scotland against a background of more certainty than there might otherwise be. I think that's entirely correct.
Richard Lockhead.
Just a point of clarification. As we discussed, you've accepted that 55% of licensed peers money from Scotland only been spent here is unsatisfactory, and you said you'd look at targets in the future. Does that include that kind of target? Are you going to look at a target of how much of the revenue raised in Scotland should be spent in Scotland?
We're on the cusp of moving into a whole new governance process, which will have a whole new set of requirements, which will come through the service license agreements, which need to be agreed with Ofcom. If I go back, it was disappointing to see the share of network and the absolute pound notes in terms of network commissioning drop in 15-16 versus 14-15. That's disappointing. And I'm very pleased to look at the forecast and to know that that will increase again, that will increase back up in 16-17. It's not a cap, there isn't a different target, but that will comfortably bring the spend back to the 8.9% plus, which is what we've been looking to achieve.
In terms of that long-term planning, Waterloo Road's been mentioned, and the fact that it wasn't recommissioned, and that's explained the fall off. I mean, when Waterloo Road moved in the storyline to Greenock, as someone who went to a comprehensive school in Greenock, I regarded it as completely absurd. But I didn't say anything at the time, like many people, because we were told this would provide the springboard, the platform for creative talent in Scotland. You would have a major drama series. However absurd the plotline was, relocated from to somewhere in the middle of England to Scotland. But clearly that's not happened. That was an example we were told. Now, that's a good few years ago now. We were told we're doing this to help long-term planning, to help the growth of the sector in Scotland. Now it's not been recommissioned. And, you know, where's the growth, you know, that we were told that the whole point of the thing was?
Well, I think what's encouraging is when we look this time next year, I guess, or when we publish the accounts in July, and we see the 16-17 numbers, we'll see that the money that was previously being spent on that commission from Waterloo Road has been moved across to new commissions, some of which Alan and Kenny spoke about earlier, which have a different flavour and a different base. So that commission, that share of networks, been replaced by something else, by a number of other titles, which we all very much hope will be a creative success as they're transmitted out. So we'll see that come back through. You know, it's certainly the case that we've seen, and the previous colleagues, David and David, spoke about this, that we've seen considerable success in daytime and studio shows as a result of bringing titles to Scotland where the skills base has been built up. And then in the next iteration, as the new titles come through, the teams in Pacific Quay, in BBC Scotland, and independent companies have been able to bid for those sorts of shows, successfully win those commissions and build returning series. So there are a number of different tools, different levers being used to build up that base. And I think...
Yeah, what Scottish companies are making drama for you from Scotland?
I'm sorry.
In terms of the we had a number of drama. First of all, River City, which we...
Aside from River City.
Within BBC Studios, we had a number of ITV studios are making Shetland for us. We've got a number of, coming up in terms of scripted comedy, we've got Still Game just about to launch, Two Doors Down. These are all Scottish companies with a huge slate coming up. We're also all of these skills in scripted, whether it's scripted comedy or scripted drama, are very complementary. And I think the craft base that we establish here, and the role of BBC Scotland in sustaining the craft base, is really important. Because to Mr. MacDonald's point, there are a number of different aspects here. Number one is the creative economy, the strength of the creative economy. Number two is the skills base that we have, the capacity that the industry has to actually provide. And as I think that we've had a number of initiatives we've done in partnerships, whether it was with Skills Development Scotland, both at entry-level schemes for apprentices, which has been a fantastic record for BBC Scotland in that sort of level of encouragement. But the point, Convener, that you're referring to in terms of portrayal and representation, that is equally important, because I personally believe that when you have a story that's rooted in a particular place, that, if you like, is authentic, the success of that is likely to travel not only to the UK but also on a global basis. But it's important for either the BBC studios or for the independent companies to have a mix.
Peter, just add two quick points there. Just one around drama specifically, and I would kind of refer the committee back to the Director General's note back in May, which did focus on drama and talked about a writer's room and talked about some investment and commissioning that would happen in that area. Those are the types of things that we need to do, as well as just looking at the kind of spend numbers around this. We talked earlier about kind of better partnerships with agencies in Scotland, and I'm absolutely passionate that that's something that we really take forward and move to a different level, because I think that we heard from the first panel here about some of the building blocks you need to put in place to reach that position of returning series and returning shows, and that itself starts to kind of create much more of a kind of feeling around sustainabilities and retaining jobs and skills in Scotland.
Jackson?
A quick supplementary. I mean, Anne Bulford talked about the studios, productions, Songs of Praise, Holby City were on that list. We heard earlier this morning how Invest Northern Ireland has already moved to approach the independents in Northern Ireland who might be in a position to bid for some of these productions, to work in partnership with them. And I suppose it's a question for Ken Macquarie and Alan Dixon. Do you believe Scottish Enterprise and the other agencies that are available in Scotland are working similarly to support the independent sector in Scotland so that it is in a position to make sensible offers to potentially bid for some of these productions, or is there a danger that unless perhaps with the support of the Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise becomes a little bit more proactive in this sector, that those other areas, countries like Northern Ireland, Wales, where their development sectors are more actively engaged, that they'll secure these productions, whereas Scotland might miss out?
I think the fact that John McCormick is chairing a sort of review, which will report at the end of the year, you know, and looking at this specific question, I think it probably answers the question, Mr. Callow, that we can do better in this area. But I await the conclusions, you know, from that review. But in terms of coordination and whether that, we will take the responsibility for the BBC's part in that, whether we can, all of us who are involved in spending the public pound, can get more value from that pound by longer term planning, a different type of conversation. Let's await the report at the end of the year. But we're certainly open to doing things differently, to listening to what's required from our partners.
Yeah, the other just quick point I would make, Mr. Carlow, is that this is a huge change that you refer to in terms of opening up the BBC's commissioning slate to competition. We've heard last week about that being delivered from a network perspective, but those changes will happen locally within Scotland, and it's a really good point about just the level of preparedness that we can make sure happens in advance of that. But on all our future plans for BBC Studios and opening up the market, we are engaged in what I hope is a productive dialogue, first and foremost, with our in-house teams, but also with PACT, which we've met two or three times. Rosina Robson was on the panel earlier, and certainly any other stakeholders that we think would have a positive impact in having further discussions, we'd be delighted to do so.
Okay, we've just got one last question from Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. Mr. McCorrie, in your comments earlier you spoke about also the new role and the promotion of Scottish programmes. So you spoke about the new role, marketing, research and the nations and regions talent. I put the question to the previous panel in terms of it's not just about commissioning of the programmes, it's about the promotion of the programmes. Now, how do you see your role going forward in terms of the promotion of Scottish-based programmes, Scottish Commission programmes?
I think, first of all, in getting these programmes to the audience, making sure that we get a wide audience for these programmes, both in Scotland and across the UK, is absolutely critical. I would be arguing, you know, and putting the case for, in terms of prioritisation, where we have specific titles that we want to absolutely make an impact, ensuring that from the very early days of commissioning, right through to the transmission, that we have a plan in how we're going to get that to the audience. And we've been investing recently in a whole number of different areas, particularly in social media, which is for getting to a young audience. It's important to make sure that you are where the younger audience is consuming the content. That's been a really successful strategy for us in BBC Scotland. Basically, we measure the success in terms of views and also the reach of a particular programme. We're looking at these two metrics are the key metrics as far as we're concerned at the moment. We may change that because we're looking at the total media experience across the BBC. That's a project that's been led across the UK. We are trying to assess how the audiences are consuming your content, whether it's on different platforms, mobile, tablet, social media, online. These are issues that every company, if you like, is wrestling with at the moment to get the right ways of measuring it. But that's our first stab at it at the moment, Mr. McMillan. But I think it's a key role.
Okay, I'd like to thank our panel for coming today, and I look forward to having an ongoing relationship between the BBC and this committee. Can you just give me an assurance that the BBC will continue to provide us, or will provide us, with detailed information on operations, income and spend in Scotland?
Yes.
Yes, of course. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.